Greetings everyone, and welcome to the online lecture series of microprocessor systems. This is our fifth lecture of this series, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about the basic computer instructions and the instruction set completeness. What types of instructions do we have and how to differentiate between them? So let's get started. So let's first talk about what is an instruction set. Every processor has its own set of instructions that the processor understands. And out of those instructions, the processor will not understand any other instruction. For example, if there is no hardware to support some instruction and we give that instruction to the computer, it will not understand it because it was not hardwired to decode that particular code. We will get an error in the first place while compiling that instruction, because the compiler will also not understand the instruction. But if we somehow forcefully upload a machine code to a computer that was not in there in the hard wires of its decoders, it will not understand it. So we are limited to use the provided set of instructions for a given computer. For this basic computer that we are discussing right now in this course, it has around 25 instructions in its instruction set. The PIC microcontroller we are going to use has around 100. Some other microcontrollers have around 200 to 300, and some very complex CIS-based microprocessors have around 1000 and even more instructions in their instruction set. The basic purpose of defining an instruction set is to utilize all the hardware capabilities of our computer. Those capabilities are defined by the computer architecture. In computer architecture, we define what we want to do. And based on that, we go to the computer organization and we say how we want to do it. And we introduce those capabilities into the computer using hardware design of those modules. And that instruction set is then developed to effectively utilize all those capabilities of a computer. So in this particular computer, we have already developed a lot of hardware. So let's revise which types of hardware we have developed. We have developed a memory, a common bus system to connect different registers. We have developed different registers, general purpose and special function registers to store addresses and data and instructions. And we have developed an arithmetic logic and shift unit to perform arithmetic logic and shift micro operations onto the data. And now we want to develop an instruction set that can actually control those hardware parts that we have developed and execute those instructions seamlessly, those operations seamlessly. And as we discussed in the definition of a computer, that a computer should have this, and this minimum capability to be called a computer. And to achieve that capability, we define some requirements for the instruction set as well. Based on those requirements, we define the hardware. And now based on the same requirements and some additional requirements, we are going to define the instruction set as well. So the instruction set of a computer is complete for a computer. Like if we want to call something a computer, it should have a complete instruction set. And a complete instruction set should have these capabilities that are listed here. It should have some arithmetic logic and shift instructions to manipulate the data. Makes sense. It should have instructions to control the data movement between different modules, memory, processor, and other registers. Makes sense. It should have some input and output instructions to interact with the environment. Makes sense. And then at number three, if we see, it should have some program flow control instructions. Now, what are program flow control instructions? We saw that the program is a set of instructions, and those instructions are placed inside the memory and are fetched one by one by giving an incrementing address, and that address was provided by the program counter. And the program counter keeps incrementing after execution of every instruction. So one instruction is executed, then the second, then the third, then the fourth. Every time the program counter increments, just the next instruction is fetched and decoded and executed. But what if we want to change the flow of program? And why do we want to change the flow of a program? I'll give you a simple example in C language. So we have, if x is greater than 20, y plus plus, else y minus minus. Just a very simple example. This is your instruction number 1, instruction number 2, instruction number 3, and instruction number 4. So in this instruction, you will just compare x with a fixed number 20, and if it is greater than 20, then you will execute just the next instruction and you will increment y. And if it was not greater than 20, what would happen? It will skip the next instruction. It will not execute this instruction, but it will skip it and it will jump to else and it will execute this instruction. So now we have skipped one instruction from our program. We have not executed, just write next instruction. And here we controlled the flow of program using an instruction if. If this condition is true, skip the next instruction. So we are controlling the flow of program using an instruction. We are not letting only the program counter to control the flow of instructions or execution of the program. And that's why we want program flow control instructions. Similarly, the previous example that we had was x is equal to 20 OUT x here, and then increment x, and then we said JUMP here. Let's say this is instruction 0, 1, 2, and 3. And this is address number 4. So if we had not jumped from location number 3 to location number 1 and executed that same instruction again, our program counter would have incremented and executed this empty place, the next instruction. And we did not want that. We want to control the flow of our program and we want to jump to a previous instruction or a next instruction based on our requirements, based on certain conditions. So that is where program flow control instructions jump in. And a computer is incomplete without program flow control instructions, because we cannot have loops, we cannot have conditional checks, we cannot have any decision making capabilities in a computer if we do not have program flow control instructions. So we have effectively 4 different types of instructions, or 4 different categories of instructions that are must to be included in a computer instruction set. Now, for this basic computer, we are going to develop the instruction set, and we are going to proceed towards the exact instructions that this basic computer is going to be possessing. So let's start. The basic computer instructions for this basic computer are divided into 3 technical types: memory reference instructions, input-output instructions, and register reference instructions. And we already saw that our instruction had the first 12 bits dedicated to the address of the operand and the remaining 4 bits dedicated for the opcode. That was just the simplistic approach. Now we are going into the details, that in which case it would be address, in which case it would be the operation itself, and the opcode is not 4 bits, rather it is 3 bits, and the last bit, the MSB, has some other functions. So starting with the memory reference instructions, because we have already discussed a part of them, we need to have a 12-bit address. We already determined that, because we want to address 4096 locations, that is 2 raised to power 12. So we need to have 12-bit address to address 4096 locations. Then we can have a 4-bit opcode. But here we are not having a 4-bit opcode, but rather a 3-bit opcode. Opcode defines the operation we want to perform. Add, subtract, increment, move, clear, decrement, etc. So a 3-bit opcode can have maximum 8 combinations. This means, are we limited to only 8 instructions in this computer? No, we already said that we are going to have 25 instructions in this computer. How? Even if we include the 4th bit in the opcode, 2 raised to power 4 is 16. It is still less than 25. So, how are we going to achieve 25 instructions using a 4-bit opcode? We'll see that. Let's see. A 3-bit opcode can have these combinations. So, we have 8 combinations for this 3-bit opcode. The 4th bit, I, is telling us whether the address we have given here in the next 12 bits is a direct address or an indirect address. So, we have just 8 different combinations for the opcode. The same instruction will be executed out of these 8 or 7, whether the address is direct or indirect, just the mode of addressing will be changed. So this 4th bit is not changing the instruction itself, it is just changing the mode of addressing. Now, the author of this book has very intelligently divided these into 7 plus 1 different combinations. So these 7 combinations are for memory reference instructions where an address is needed in the rest of the 12 bits. And this 111 combination, this one particular combination, is not included in the memory reference instructions. And if we see that the remaining two instructions, the register reference and input output instruction, in those instructions we do not need a memory at all. If we do not need a memory, do we need an address for the memory? Do special function registers have address? No, they don't. Special function registers do not have any address. When we want to read a special function register, we select it using the bus. When we want to write a special function register, we just set the load pin of that particular register to 1. So there is no address for the special function registers. And input-output registers and other special function registers are all special function registers and they don't have address at all. So we do not need any address for those type of instructions which are not involving the memory at all. So, what does this mean? This means that these 12 bits are consumed by the address only for the instructions that require the operand to be placed or to be fetched from the memory. If the memory is not involved, there will be no address in these 12 locations, but rather these 12 locations will now be free for any different type of function we want to allot them. And what we want to do is that we have already consumed our 7 combinations of opcode out of the 8. So we say that whenever our opcode is not 7111, that is 7, and it is some other number, it is a memory reference instruction. And whenever our opcode is 7, it is one of these two types of instructions. So, this third one is just used to determine whether it is a memory reference instruction or a non-memory reference instruction. And when it is determined, it is 111, the rest of the 12 bits are now free. So, which operation we want to perform out of those input-output instructions and out of those register reference instructions, we can get from these 12 bits. And whether it is an input-output or register reference instruction is again decided by this I bit. So if it was not memory reference instruction, there is no addressing. So this I is also free now. If it is 1, it is input-output. If it is 0, it is register reference. Let's explain it using a flow chart. It will be easier to understand. So our instruction is put into the instruction register here. And then the 3 bits of opcode are checked. If the opcode is 111, then the rest of the 12 bits are not address and it is not a memory reference instruction. But if the opcode is not 111 but is from 0 to 6, it is a memory reference instruction. then we are going to check the fourth bit. If that bit is 1, it is an indirect memory address, and if it is 0, it is a direct memory access. So indirect addressing and direct addressing. And in this case also, if our fourth bit was 1, it was IO instruction, input output instruction, and if it was 0, it was a register reference instruction. So this flowchart is used to differentiate between different types of instructions and to differentiate between different operations that we want to perform on our data. So we have 7 memory reference instructions, as we saw, 0 to 6, and we can have up to 2 raised to power 12 register reference instructions and up to 2 raised to power 12 input output instructions, but we don't have hardware for them. So we decided to have only 12 register reference instructions and 6 input output instructions based on our hardware limitations. So a total of 25 instructions are there. And this is the summary of those 25 instructions. In memory reference instructions, we have AND, ADD, those require 2 operands. One is coming from memory and the other one is in the accumulator. Then we have LDA, load accumulator from the memory. So the memory is involved. We want to preload the accumulator with any second operand. And then we have STA, store the content of accumulator back into the memory. We cannot leave the result of our arithmetic logic or shift micro operations into the accumulator forever because it is not memory. If we want to store the contents of accumulator, we have to store them into the memory. So memory is involved. Then these 3 instructions are program flow control instructions. One is branch unconditionally. Branch unconditionally is equivalent to jump. Jump unconditionally to the given address. Similarly, branch and save address unconditionally jumps, but while jumping, before jumping, saves its current address of instruction somewhere in the memory. Why is it required? Again, I will give you an example of C language because you are already familiar with that. You have some program here and you have a subroutine or a function here. You call this function from this point, you execute this function and then return from this function and return to this point from where you left. So if you do not save the return address, you cannot never return to the point from where you jumped. So if you want to just jump unconditionally to somewhere and don't want to return, it's okay, you can use branch unconditionally. But if you want to return to that position, you have to save address. Now another question that can come to the mind of students is that, then why we don't use the BSA always? Let me tell you why. Because you don't always need to save the address. And saving the address consumes 1 to 2 more clock cycles and thus makes the process slower. So when you don't need to save the address, you do not waste those clock cycles and thus you have 2 separate options, 2 separate instructions for jumping unconditionally. And then the last memory reference instruction is ISZ. Increment and skip if 0. Increment what? If I write ISZ20, it will go to address number 20, increment the data stored on 20, and see if that data becomes 0 after incrementing. Now, can anything become 0 after incrementing? Yes, if it is a negative number, and yes, if it is overflowed. So if you have a 4-bit number, it can go from 0000 up to 1111. And if you further increment it, it will become 0000 after overflowing or rolling over. So if you want to increment a memory location and then skip the next instruction if it was 0, then you want to use this ISC instruction. So let's see where it can be used. Let's do a small example of its application. And the same example we are going to use that we did in our last program. X is equal to 20. Then we have count is equal to negative 100 And then we have OUT X, increment X, ISZ, count, jump, again, and HLT, halt, or end. So, what's happening here? We have a variable X in the memory, and we load it with a number 20. Then we have another variable count in the memory, and we load it with negative 100. And then we start our loop. So we send the contents of location number 20 to the output, increment the location 20 to 21, increment our count from minus 100 to minus 99, and check if it was 0 or not. Minus 99 is not 0. So next instruction will not be skipped, and our program will jump unconditionally to this location again. Now, X is 21, so at output, the data of location number 21 will be sent. Again, the X will be 22. The count will be incremented again, and it will become 98. And now, 98 is not equal to 0, so again, negative 98 is not equal to 0, so it will jump again. And it will keep sending the data of location number 20, 21, 22, 23, up to 99 to the output. And then at that point, it was negative 1. So, increment negative 1, negative 1 plus 1 is 0. So, at this point, the ISC instruction is now true. Increment and skip if 0. If is a condition. So now when the count was 0, it will skip this instruction and it will jump directly to the next instruction. It will not jump again. And it will halt the computer. So we have only sent 100 locations to the output starting from number 20 to 119. Then we have register reference instructions. Clear accumulator, clear the carry. E is the carry flag here. Complement accumulator, complement carry, circular shift right, circular shift left, and increment accumulator. So these are the accumulator based instructions. HLT is halt, stop the clock of the computer. Not requires memory at all. All of these instructions do not require memory. And then we have these four program flow control instructions. Skip if positive, accumulator. So no memory is involved, only accumulator is checked. If it is positive, the next instruction will be skipped. And same here, if it is negative, the next instruction will be skipped. And same here, if it is zero, the next instruction will be skipped. And then again, same here, if the carry flag or E flag is zero, the next instruction will be skipped. So no memory is being involved in any of these instructions. And then finally, we have input and output instructions. And let us just discuss these two input-output instructions right now, INP and OUT. We are not going into the rest of four instructions that are related to interrupts and flags, and we are going to discuss these in detail when we are going to discuss the interrupts and flags in PIC microcontroller. So INP inputs a character and saves it to an accumulator, and OUT takes the character from accumulator and sends it to the output. So this is our complete instruction set of 25 instructions for our basic computer. And this is what we are going to follow now. And here the hexadecimal codes of all the instruction is given. So our instruction set is now complete. We have computational instructions, transfer instructions, control data flow control instructions, and input output instructions all covered and all discussed in this lecture. So I hope the instruction set of a basic computer would be clear to you now. And in the next lecture, we are going to discuss about the execution of instruction and the timing and control and the instruction cycle. So see you in the next lecture, and till then, take care, stay safe, goodbye.